discuss about hyponatremia. So why I have taken this topic of hyponatremia? So there are two reasons. One is the hyponatremia, what we are seeing in daily, day-to-day common practice, is the commonest electrolyte disturbance in ICU as well as in ward. And second thing is hyponatremia, it indicates sometimes underlying some serious disorder, such as malignancy. So I am going to discuss this topic under these headings: introduction and epidemiology, pathogenesis, classifications, clinical feature, investigation, treatment and complications. Now what is an introduction and epidemiology? So what I told, hyponatremia is commonly encountered and there are lot of formula to correct the hyponatremia. It will be very nightmare for student as well as physician, which formula to be applied and what is the formula. Next thing is, if we see overall incidence of hyponatremia, it depends on the level at what incidence was taken. If we see less than 135, incidence of hyponatremia is 15 to 30%. If we see less than 125, the incidence is 2 to 3%. It is 7% in all ambulatory patients. In USA, 1 million hospitalization per year, it is because of hyponatremia. More common in cirrhosis and heart failure. And hyponatremia, if we see all the time, commonest hyponatremia is hospital acquired hyponatremia. What we are seeing daily, day-to-day practice in ICU setup. Now before going to hyponatremia, we should know these three things. This is a very, very basics to understand the hyponatremia. First, it is not a disorder, primary disorder of sodium. It is a disorder of water imbalance. This is a very common thing. What we have to understand, it is a disorder of water imbalance. What imbalance? In hyponatremia, relatively increased water than the sodium. This is a second concept of hyponatremia. And third thing is, usually, not all cases of hyponatremia, associated with increased ADH level. Now, before going to pathogenesis, we should know this terminology, osmolarity, and what is an effective osmolarity or effective osmoles. So osmolarity is a number of particles containing 1 liter of water. So this is how we are calculating the osmolarity. It contains electrolyte and non-electrolytes. So what are the electrolytes? The list of electrolytes. What are the non-electrolytes? Commonest what we are using is urea and glucose. Now how to calculate the osmolarity? So what we are using in formula is 2 into sodium plus blood urea nitrogen divided by 2.8 plus glucose divided by 18. So what this formula indicates? So this formula, if we see, there are two things are coming. One is the sodium, second thing is glucose. So what I want to tell here, if any hyponatremia we are seeing in clinical practice, if sodium is decreased and if we see the osmolarity, it obviously it will be low osmolarity. So what we call as a true hyponatremia. There is one more entity is something like pseudo hyponatremia that I will tell in later slide. What is normal osmolarity is 285 to 295. Second concept, what is different between osmolarity and tonicity? Are they same or is it difference? So for that we should know the effective osmoles. If we see this formula, urea is not an effective osmole. Why? Because it is freely across the cell membrane. So what is an effective osmolarity? So if we remove these steps and whatever the formula is there, we call as effective osmolarity. Now whatever we are studying.
Why so?
Whatever we are studying.
Why so?
Pardon sir?
Why such urea?
Yeah, because sir, urea is a freely across the cell membrane. See,
why the glucose?
Glucose it cannot be.
You require insulin for the pushing, yes.
Correct. So why we have to study this? So whenever we are seeing this, what we have to think, is there any clinical implication of these steps or not? So that I will tell in later. If suppose somebody have high urea, what is it protection? whether it is helpful or not. So that I will tell in my subsequent slide. Now, this is a proper pathogenesis of hyponatremia. So whenever you are dealing with hyponatremia, first step is osmolarity. Is osmolarity same in all part of body? Yes, it is same in every part. From where it is handled? It is handled at hypothalamus. How it will be handled? By help of two things. So by help of raising of ADH and either you increase the water or thirst. Now, how the osmolarity will change? So depends on two things. Either there will be change in the water, whatever you are seeing gray part is change in the water, or there will be increase in the solute. If these two things are changed, will give rise to change in the osmolarity. What are the changes we are expect? Either there will be hypotonicity or hypertonicity. So when you get hypotonicity, excessive water intake, obviously it will cause hypotonicity. If excessive water excrete, will get hypertonicity. And same thing will happen with solutes. If excessive solute will get excrete, will get hypotonic plasma. If we add extra salt or solute, will get hypertonic plasma. So this is a very basics to understand hyponatremia. Now, how body will adjust to hypotonicity or hypoosmolarity? So I told in beginning slide, whenever sodium is reduced, if you apply serum osmolarity formula, there will be hypoosmolar and be referred as true hyponatremia. So what happened to hypotonic plasma? Body will try to increase the serum osmolarity. By what way? By two ways. One is stop the thirst and inhibit the ADH. So you suppress the thirst, inhibit the ADH. And all of you know ADH will go to the distal tubules and it acts there. So it will cause dilute urine in absence of ADH. Now what happens in vice versa? Hypertonic plasma. So in case of hypertonic plasma, thirst will increase and there will be excessive level of ADH will cause more concentrated urine. So this two concept is very important. In case of hypotonic plasma, there will be absence of ADH and suppression of thirst. In case of hypertonic plasma, thirst will increase and ADH will increase. So what are the ADH stimulation? There are two stimulation. One is the osmotic release. So what we are seeing in hyperosmolarity and non-osmotic release, that is a low effective plasma volume. So that will be either in renin angiotensin activation or else reduced blood pressure. So once ADH comes, it acts to the kidney, increase the blood volume and increase the plasma volume. So this is the action of ADH, what we call vasopressin. Now this is a very very important slide. I told in beginning slide only, whenever we are seeing the hyponatremia, the serum osmolarity should reduce. So once serum osmolarity reduced, the level of ADH should suppress. But that we are not seeing in clinical practice. You read this line, majority of patients with hyponatremia, vasopressin level either detectable or increased. Why it happened? What is the basic pathogenesis of this? So there are five things we have to remember. So in case of hyponatremia, ADH will release not under control of osmolarity but under control of this thing. First thing is baroreceptor mediated. Second thing is increased stimulation of central osmoreceptor, that is either because of drugs or as cytokines, what we are seeing in infection. Third thing is paraneoplastic, ectopic production of ADH. Fourth thing is augmented release of vasopressin, which acts immediately to the renal tissue level. And fifth is at the receptor level mutation. So these are the five basic mechanism of hyponatremia. Even though there is low tonicity, ideally there should be no ADH. So from where ADH will come? come because of this fire effect. Now, how to classify hyponatremia? So, classification of hyponatremia under this category, moderate hyponatremia. So, the level is 125 to 130 milliequivalent per liter. And severe and profound. What is difference between severe and profound? So obviously it is difference between UK and USA. In UK they are telling profound hyponatremia, and US they are telling severe hyponatremia, less than 125. What is acute and chronic? So duration of to say acute and chronic is 48 hours. Why this magic figure has been chosen? So I will tell in later slide. Symptomatic versus asymptomatic hyponatremia and hypotonic, isotonic and hypertonic depends on serum osmolarity. So these are the classification of hyponatremia. Whenever we are seeing the classification any topic, whether it has any clinical implication or it has any treatment, you modality will change or not. So that I will tell in later. What are the treatment is required for each class of hyponatremia. Now come to clinical feature. So obviously it depends on the level of the sodium and at what rate hyponatremia will develop. These two things are very very important. Magnitude of hyponatremia and rate at which hyponatremia will develop will give rise to symptoms. So these are the symptoms depends on severity of hyponatremia, mild, moderate and severe. Severe hyponatremia usually they are present with neurological features if they are developed faster rate. Now to understand the symptoms we should have the idea about osmolarity. What is the normal physiology? ICF versus ECF osmolarity both are equal. What happen in case of hyponatremia? ICF osmolarity will more than the ECF osmolarity. So intracellular swelling, water will transfer from extracellular to intracellular in case of low plasma osmolarity or hypo osmolarity. What happen to vice versa in case of hyper osmolarity? Water will transfer from intracellular to extracellular, what we call as swelling, what we call as shrinkage of cell. So this phenomena if we are applied to the brain, what will happen? Brain is a closed cavity, brain enters, it is present in the skull which cannot expand. So there will be brain swelling. So this is an again very very important slide. This slide indicates what are the CNS manifestation in hyponatremia. So there are two basic manifestations. One is hyponatremia per se and second thing is we are explained for or we are responsible for second type of manifestation, what we call as ODS, osmotic demyelination syndrome. How it will develop? So this is a normal brain. Whenever there is an hypotonic or hyponatremia, what is the first stage, first changes has been occurred? So first is water gain. So brain will get swollen. So this is an something occurs within a minute. So brain will expand. You can see here sulcus and gyrus will be disturbed. What is an two type of adaptation occurs? Once brain will swollen, what adaptation will occur? So either rapid adaptation or slow adaptation. Rapid adaptation is because of what? So it is because of loss of sodium and potassium, so which occurs within 3 to 4 hours. What is slow adaptation? Slow adaptation is loss of organic osmolytes which occurs within days. So once this low osmolarity sets, if we will not treat, brain will be in low osmolar state only. It will over zealously or rapidly correct, will develop ODS, and if we treat normally, again brain comes into normal osmolarity. So basically we are seeing two kind of neurological manifestation. One is because of ODS, second thing is hyponatremia per se. So what I told, within minutes swellings of brain will occur, rapid adaptation which occurs within few hours, that is 3 to 4 hours, and slow adaptation which occurs in days. Now what is HNE? HNE is nothing but hyponatremic encephalopathy that depends on magnitude of hyponatremia, sex, age and rapidity of onset. So if we develop hyponatremia less than 0.5 milliequivalent per hour in 24 hours, usually it will be uncomplicated. Again, this is unstudied. If we develop hyponatremia more than 1 milliequivalent per liter, it will be complicated and lethal. Now, what is the effect of HNE over the age? So this is very important. HNE is more severe in pre-adolescent. Why? Because the brain reaches maximum size by 6 years of age. We are rarely seen at the age of 55 years. This manifestation we are seeing less than 20 years. So brain reaches maximum size by 6 years. Skull reaches maximum size by 16 years. So at the 16 years, skull will expand. At the 6 years, brain reaches maturity. So if we will see that if any rapid collection or if hyponatremia because of one's brain will get swollen, the in case of less than 20 years, the brain will not get any occupied in the skull. So the size in the skull will be less. So this is the reason why we are seeing commonly in pre-adolescent or young patient. So because their skull poses more steric constraint than the adult. So this is the reason. Now, second thing is in hyponatremia, there will be hypoxia. What is the reason of hypoxia? I want to stress this thing. Whenever the brain expands, it compresses the brain vasculature, which gives rise to neurogenic pulmonary edema, what we are seeing commonly. In case of heart failure, SpO2 is 95%, sodium we will see 115, patient is drowsy or sensorium is altered. Whether you will correct this hyponatremia or not. So this is a basic thing. If you see the thing, if you correct the sodium, not up to the mark, but slightly correction of sodium, which will improve the hypoxia and it improves the neurogenic component of pulmonary edema. So this is a recent report came from Kidney International 2018. What I want to stress here is the recent study have suggested that hyponatremia carries significant risks and neurological impairment even in absence of brain edema. Even if brain is normal, there is no edema, but hyponatremia, sodium is 131, 132, normal sodium is 135, it carries risk. What are the risks? So this is a major risk, bone risk.
Now they got the answer.
Pardon, sir?
In AI, yeah. They got the, they are informing that there is no brain edema. And still the problem is there. Yeah. Now they got the answer.
Yes, sir. So, this. So chronic hyponatremia, they have taken the patient of less than 135, 131 to 135. What they have found? Brain is not swollen. There is only hyponatremia. What are the CNS manifestations? Unsteady gait, second thing is confusion and lethargy, frequent fall and bone fracture. So this is uncommonly what they have found in recent journal. What is the incidence?
The article, you know, go to the previous slide. You know, the ultimately these manifestations of chronic hyponatremia depends on your bone storage of sodium. It is not that emphasized. Those who are having good bone storage of sodium, they do not develop chronic hyponatremia, even though they are taking less salt or other situation. But those who are having bone sodium, which is less,
yes,
they develop acute and chronic hyponatremia very easily.
So this is the second part, sir. What you told, sir, decreased bone mineralization and increased osteoclastic activity. But as such, sir, this unsteady gait, confusion and lethargy, this to be handled at brain level.
These are the manifestations of chronic mild
hyponatremia.
So because what, they observe this thing, that what is the cognitive defects, unstable gates and those things, yes, sir, which ultimately they thought. But there is no brain swelling or not, how they could judge?
Sir, that only judge with what in detail article I have seen.
You are going between the line. Yeah. See, because whether the edema is there or not. See, now they are posting, there is no edema. And still the problem is there. You see, whether they went for a fractional MRI and differentiated, then there is no.
So, that, what sir, they called, they have done the sodium perfused MRI.
Absolutely.
Sodium, sodium perfused MRI. So that's what sir, I got told in detail, but the outcome of so at least this thing.
There is an accommodation on the dimension level also for us. People who are chronically in low soil, they don't need soil, people who are in starvation levels, they have this accommodation level. You see the giant monies, they don't eat for so many. Still, it's basically chronic hypoglycemia can be accommodated, which is not for acute or other reasons.
So this is an overall incidence of fracture, comparison of controlled versus non-fracture in case of hyponatremia. Now, manifestation of hyponatremic encephalopathy, so I told already, most important for us is what we are neglecting is non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Now, how to approach a hyponatremia? First step, whenever we are showing the less sodium, repeat the sodium. Second thing, you ask the history of drugs. What are the drugs? So there are five drugs are very, very important. First is diuretic. Always ask about thiazide. Listen, loop diuretics alone very, very rarely cause hyponatremia.
Yeah, aquaretics. They are more of the aquaretics.
So thiazide is a commonest diuretics which cause hyponatremia, which is second drugs, tricyclic antidepressant, SSRI, carbamazepine, antiepileptic, and sodium valproate, NSAIDs. So these are the 5-6 drugs are commonest what we are seeing in day-to-day practice. Now how thiazide will cause hyponatremia? Very commonly. So thiazide will cause, after once we'll give thiazide, it will cause distal tubular dehydration. So once it will cause distal tubular dehydration, volume depletion, stimulate release of ADH. This first mechanism. Second thing is increase water retention independent of ADH. What is the micro level mechanism? We don't know. But after giving thiazide, there will be initial weight gain will be there. So this is a third step. Fourth, what is true versus pseudo hyponatremia? How to differentiate? So always difference with serum osmolarity. So true hyponatremia, I told, serum osmolarity will be less than 275. What we call is hypotonic hyponatremia. Pseudo hyponatremia, osmolarity will be normal, we call as isotonic hyponatremia. Translocational, osmolarity will be high. If you remember the formula of osmolarity, in that glucose are coming. If anybody has high glucose, it will cause translocational osmolarity will increase, so we call as hypertonic hyponatremia. What we are seeing clinically is, suppose patient has been posted for TURP and after TURP we are giving normal saline for cleaning of the bladder for long standing, so it will cause translocational hyponatremia because that contain the glycerin. So glycerin is again high osmolar solution. How to classify? So already I told, suppose low osmolar, we call as hypotonic or true hyponatremia. Normal, we call as isotonic. These are the reason. I will tell why this will cause serum osmolarity or hyponatremia will occur. Now, pseudo hyponatremia means osmolarity will be normal. So it occurs because of solid phase of plasma. So normally solid phase of plasma it occupies 6 to 8%. So pseudohyponatremia causes are reproteins and increased triglyceride level. This occurs because of lab error. What previously we were using to measure sodium is flame photometry, but nowadays we are changed to the ISC, that is iron specific electrode. So with ISC the chance of pseudohyponatremia is less, but with flame photometry chance of pseudohyponatremia will be more. This is again important. If sodium is decreased by 1.6 milliequivalent, if glucose is increased by more than 100 milligram per deciliter. So this is called as something like translocational hyponatremia. So we have
it is not vice versa.
Pardon, sir?
It is not vice versa. If glucose increases or decreases by 100, then sodium will inversely increase or decrease.
Yes, sir.
Or sodium decreases, then glucose.
It is vice versa.
It's inversely.
So now we'll go to the next step. Once we found hypotonic hyponatremia, what is the, you see the symptoms. If severe symptoms, you treat it. Don't think about which type of hyponatremia. If it is not there, now your question will come whether it is hypovolemic, euvolemic and hypervolemic. See, this is very important. In first slide only I told hyponatremia is disorder of water. What happened? Water relatively or absolutely will increase. Either it will be relatively increased or absolutely will increase. In case of hypovolemic hyponatremia, total amount of water is reduced, but if we see compare of sodium, sodium will go reduced drastically. It will come down. Total body salt will reduce. In case of euvolemic, total body salt is normal. Amount of water will increase in case of euvolemic, and in case of hypervolemic, total salt also increase and total body water also increase. So this can be explained with this formula, what we called as Edelman equation. What Edelman equation will tell? Total body water, if you see in case of hypovolemic, either it will be hypo or else normal. So in case of hypovolemic hyponatremia, total body water is either normal or decreased. What are the things in which it increase? In case of euvolemic and hypervolemic hyponatremia, total body water will increase. What is its clinical implication? So that I will tell in treatment slide. So this is called as Edelman equation. Now to see for volumic status, we have to go with clinical, our clinical knowledge. What is the sensitivity? It is 0.5 to 0.8 and specificity also 0.3 to 0.5. So always go with multiple features. Single features does not tell this is an hypovolemia or hypervolemia. Now next step is
how to judge. See, this is a very dicey situation.
Yeah.
Huh? And commonest is this: a diarrhea vomiting, and the person gets the hyponatremia. And how you assess a thing? See, obvious is see loss of pressures and the sunken eyeballs and those things. Even any blind person can detect.
So, but, so on clinical base, what on examination wise, is there any postural drop?
Absolutely.
Tachycardia. If we will go to biochemistry parameter in hypovolemia, uric acid level will be increased.
Postural fall is the key.
Yeah. So, urine sodium, next step, step 5, urine sodium. Urine sodium is 20, more than 20 or less than 20. So how it will help to narrow the diagnosis? If you are dealing with hypovolemia and urine sodium is more than 20, the commonest first things what we are seeing is diuretics. Any previous history of diuretic is there or not? If less than 10, we are asking about history of diarrhea or loose motion, vomiting. Same thing, isoosmolar. So urine sodium is more than 20. We'll ask commonly what we are seeing in day-to-day practice is SIDH. If more than 20, we have to search for SIDH. And hypervolemic. So hypervolemic causes are cirrhosis and renal failure. Now how to treat the hyponatremia? So treatment is with three, if you want to use or not. First question, 3% normal saline. How will you give? What is the target? So target is 10 millimol per 24 hours. After that, you increase by 8 millimol per liter in 24 hours. Till what you will treat? Till symptoms improved or sodium reached to 130. Now this is a very very important slide. How to calculate the sodium with 3% NaCl. So this is formula called as Edrigo-Madaya's formula. What we are using for both hypo as well as hypernatremia. So change in the sodium equal to, this is called as delta sodium, equal to infusionate sodium minus serum sodium divided by total body water plus 1. So this is how we have to calculate the total body water. Now we will go with example. 60 years male, age 60 kg, weight 60 kg, serum sodium is 105. You want to correct with 3% NaCl. So infusionate sodium minus serum sodium, it comes to 408. What is total body water? It is 36. What is change in the sodium or delta sodium? It is 11. So what this indicates? 11. So 11 indicates if you give 1 liter of 3% NaCl in 24 hours, you will increase the sodium by 11 milliequivalent. So this is called as Edrigo-Madaya's formula for hyponatremia. Same formula will apply for hypernatremia. Serum sodium is 160. You want to correct with 0.9 NaCl or 5% D. How much amount of 0.9 NaCl required or 5% D is required? So what is infusionate sodium minus patient sodium if you want to correct with normal saline? Minus 6. What is with 5% D? Minus 160. What is total body water? Same. Change in the sodium? Minus 0.1. So if you give 1 liter of normal saline, it reduces the sodium only with minus 0.1. So in a day you have to give 100 liter of normal saline to reduce the sodium with NaCl. If you want to correct with 5% D, you have to require only 2.3 liters of 5D. Dextrose. So is it clear?
Why all these gibberish?
Pardon, sir?
Why this all you go by the formulas?
Yeah. So that I told in treatments that if we correct over repeatedly correction, it will cause ODS, osmotic demyelination syndrome.
So how frequently it is? And how you diagnose the central contained
cellulitis? So how to manage? So whenever you are dealing with management, you ask yourself two things. Whether symptoms severe or not, whether it develops what rate, acute or chronic. Any severe hyponatremia, don't think. You treat with 3% NaCl. Whatever I am telling, this is an European guideline. And guidelines are always made to disrupt it. So we are not using in clinical practice this thing. Give 3% NaCl. That is 150 ml over 20 minutes. We are going always on infusion to avoid ODS in routine clinical practice. What is treatment of moderately hyponatremia? When you call moderate hyponatremia, if you have nausea without vomiting, confusion or headache, what is the treatment? Same as 3% NaCl, 150 ml. Check after 20 minutes. If it is increased, you stop or else you give infusion. sugar. So this is a moderate hyponatremia. What is the treatment of acute? If it develops less than 48 hours, we have to give 3% NaCl infusion for acute hyponatremia. What is the treatment of chronic? So this is very, very important. What guideline says, if hyponatremia cannot be classified, considered as a chronic hyponatremia, what we are seeing clinically in OPD basis, if we are not classified, it is a chronic hyponatremia. Now, chronic hyponatremia, circulatory volume is reduced. So that is called as hypovolemic. You give normal saline and target your sodium by 0.5 to 1, whatever the 10 milli equivalent per 24 hours. If ECF is expanded and circulatory volume is not reduced, so we call as hypervolemic. You restrict the fluid. So this is called as hypervolemic. Now, what is the role of weptans? Whether you use weptans or not. So what study says? Increased number of death in those patients treated with weptans. Question, when to give weptans? So weptans is indicated in any asymptomatic chronic once patient stabilized for long term management. Never ever using acute symptomatic hyponatremia. So long term management, last option is weptan. You go with first water restriction, second thing is urea and demoglobocycline. Urea we are not using in clinical practice, and third thing is weptans. Why we are not using weptans? Because it will cause again liver toxicity. Now what happened? Complication. Why we have to apply this formula? So complication is ODS. The commonest what we are seeing is osmotic demyelination syndrome. That is because of rapid shift of water from intracellular space. So diagnosis is by MRI. MRI is more sensitive. We can miss sometimes CT scan with early ODS because lesion do not become apparent for up to 4 weeks. What is the treatment of ODS? Why the pathogenesis it will happen? So ODS is nothing but brain dehydration in one word. It is brain dehydration. So brain protein will get denatured. And what happened? It caused oligodendrocyte death, microglia activation and brain inflammation. So pathogenesis is sodium overshoot or brain dehydration. How to treat ODS? The correction of hyponatremia with urea and slow correction of sodium. These are the two commonest major what we are using in ODS. Now, this is for dialysis. Actually, we are not.
ODS takes place. You see, whatever the measures which you are taking, because you don't detect early and you don't act properly.
Actually, ODS happens when your insulin has given you enough time.
Absolutely.
And you have not.
Absolutely.
You have not. Now, patient on hemodialysis. If we see the old patient on chronic hemodialysis, and we will see the electrolyte before dialysis, what they are practicing in USA. This patient have sodium not 135. It will be less than 135 only in all CKD patient on hemodialysis. That is because of hypervolemic or dilutional. It will be either 131 or 132. So how to manage such patient? So one thing is, ideally we have to check for all chronic maintenance dialysis every time serum electrolytes before dialysis. But that is not possible in our setup. So what we can do? Dialyze at sodium concentration. We have to keep it in mind, daily we can correct up to 10 milli equivalent. So difference between patient sodium and dialyzed is maximum is 15 to 20. So what is an upper limit to correct the dialyzed sodium? Upper limit to correct the dialyzed sodium is 145. What is the lower limit? Lower limit is 128. So we'll go with one example. Suppose one lady will come.
Thank you. Go on. See, the point was this, that if you get a 131 sodium in a person who is on a maintenance hemodialysis on a long term, the cognitive effect is because of that acid. You see, if you want the quality of life of such CKD patient, 5 years, 7 years, etc., and if you keep the persistent hyponatremia, whatever the cognitive effect which we see later on, is probably this is one of the factors. And if you correct it, probably the cognition can be improved.
The quality of life will be improved.
Absolutely.
So, I'll give you one example how to correct hyponatremia in dialysis patient. So, you give the quantum 5% dextrose. What is the mechanism of this? So, if suppose you have one patient, sodium is 105, patient is CKD, you want to do dialysis, your dialysis lowest limit dialyzed sodium is 128. So within 3 or 4 hours sodium will reach to 128. How to correct this? It will cause ODS. So to correct with 5% dextrose, you give every only 5% dextrose, 1 liter, how much? It will correct, by 3.5. So this is a very important what we are seeing in day-to-day chronic maintenance hemodialysis patient. How to set the pump speed?
What will be the infusion rate of D5 during the dialysis?
Pardon, sir?
What will be the infusion rate of that D5?
Sir, every hourly we have to give 1 liter. And whatever we are giving, that we have to take it out as an ultrafiltration. Now, how to calculate the pump speed? So ideal teaching, what they are saying, any patient with sodium of less than 120 or whatever, say you cannot go less than dialysed sodium by 128. So in such case you go with less pump speed, or what you call as CRRT. CRRT is always better option for the very low hyponatremia during dialysis. So what is the take home message? So it is a disorder of water balance. Next thing is presence of symptoms and severity of depends on magnitude of hyponatremia and rate at which it is correct. Normal maximum compensation decrease in plasma osmolarity requires for 48 hours. Avoid rapid correction. 3% NaCl only 3 indication, acute hyponatremia, severe hyponatremia with symptoms, moderately symptomatic hyponatremia. Uremia provides some protection against ODS, because I told urea is ineffective osmol. What is the serum osmolarity is used to differentiate true versus pseudo hyponatremia or translocational. What is the use of urine osmolarity? Urine osmolarity diagnosis of ADH independent hyponatremia, what we are calling as primary polydipsia or beer potomania or PTOS or low solute intake hyponatremia. So basically depends on ADH, we divide into two: ADH dependent, what I told till now, ADH independent. If urine osmolarity less than 100, you think about ADH independent hyponatremia with history.